Hello everyone, welcome to my channel or welcome back to my channel. I feel like a lot of people maybe that aren't subscribed to me might see this video, so I want to give you a little introduction of who I am, and I guess we'll get into my story. So my name is Chelsea. I am in my mid to late 20s. I have a beautiful daughter named Mia and she was born in 2020. Yeah, I feel like that's like pretty much my backstory. I make videos on here about my life and that includes being a mom. I try to show the realistic side of that. If you are on this video, I hope it's out of curiosity versus maybe going through the same thing. So I hope that whatever the reasoning is, I hope that this video might help you in some way to understand what the process was like for me, or if you're just generally curious, if you are going through something similar, just know that you're not alone. I know that doesn't make it any better, but I feel like it can help you to understand that although your story is different, it can happen to literally anyone. And I feel like for me, I always thought like, oh, like if you have a history of miscarriages, like maybe, you know, you're more likely to have miscarriages. Having a daughter, a fully healthy pregnancy, like honestly, I feel like my pregnancy was pretty picture perfect. And then going into my second pregnancy, I really thought everything was gonna be the same. I had no fears, nothing until closer to what I'm going to talk about, and I started to get really like nervous about it. I had no fears getting pregnant. I was very excited to get pregnant again, and I think for my next one that'll be different, but we'll just get into my story. I did make notes because I'm trying to keep like a clear head about what I want to tell you guys. I don't want to be too emotional, but I think that sharing my story can maybe make someone else not feel so alone or just educate them, because I know I've seen other people's videos on their miscarriages and a lot of them have been like, oh, I woke up and I was bleeding. And for me, that wasn't the case. So I just want to tell you guys my story. And also I feel like I've been really struggling to be motivated and to stay on top of things, and just everything that I had pictured my life to be like currently obviously isn't the same. So I've been having a hard time trying to like get through that and process that. So that is kind of where I've been, and I didn't want to keep this secret from people who know me or follow me. I want to be able to speak openly about the struggles that I've had in my life and what I'm going through. So I wanted to speak openly about this as well. So I'm gonna try to keep it non-emotional as much as I can. But yeah, let's just get into it. Those are the backstories, the disclaimers, all that stuff. So here we go. So we found out we were pregnant with our second baby. We were super excited. We told people a lot earlier, I feel like, than we did with the first pregnancy. And that was because I had thought, you know, second pregnancy, my first pregnancy was great. Like, what different, you know, it's gonna be the same. Everything's gonna be perfect. So we told our friends and family, which I'm happy we told them, because it was nice to have that support and not have to be like, hey, this happened and now this is where I'm at. It was more so like, hey, here's what happened, and they could help me through it. So it's nice to have that support. We didn't obviously like publicly announce it or anything like that. So pretty much we were on like a mini vacation. I did have a little bit of bleeding. I was scared about it and so was Brandon, but I just like reassured him that, you know, that's normal, that can happen. I was kind of freaked out because it didn't happen with my first, so I did feel like something maybe wasn't 100%, but I was just like, keep all the negative thoughts out of your mind and let's just continue forward. We got back, I called my midwives and let them know that this happened. She reassured me that, you know, this stuff happens often, it's nothing that should be like worried about, everything should be fine. The next steps would be to have my scan, which I already was set up for, so really I just had to wait for that. I actually lost the baby April 7th, but I didn't know that, so that was like the week before the scan, I believe. So going into the scan, I was really like nervous and I just like felt like something wasn't right. Maybe it was like having bled before that kind of like gave me that thought that, oh my gosh, what if something isn't right, you know, what if something is wrong. I didn't really have any crazy symptoms, but again, with my first pregnancy, I didn't either, so that wasn't really anything to compare. But I was really nervous going into it, and obviously for good reason, because I went in and I asked if my husband could come because I didn't think I was gonna get this emotional. We've barely started. So my first pregnancy was during COVID. Pretty much like we got pregnant right before COVID happened, and he couldn't come to any appointments. So he came with me. We were excited that he could be in the room and see everything, whatever. So I was like, can he come in? And they're like, the doctor has to do the first scan, and then after that, he can come in. So I'm like, okay, cool. This was like a different place than I went to before. And then I go into the room, and the girl starts doing the scan, and it's just like, you could hear a pin drop. It was so silent. She wasn't showing me the screen whatsoever. So I was already like, what the hell's going on? Like, I want to see my baby. Why isn't she showing me anything? I'm like, oh, well, it's a different place, so maybe. Like, I'm trying to think positively. So I'm like, maybe they don't do that here or whatever. So then she was like, okay, I'm gonna get you to go to the bathroom, and then we're gonna do a vaginal one, which they put the probe up there to get a closer look at the baby. I figured if they needed me to do the probe, there was a reason for it. So I went to the bathroom, and at that point I kind of like knew something was up. They didn't call Brandon into the room, obviously, and I kind of wish he was there, but at the same time I get it. But it was hard to go through by myself. So I went to the bathroom, they did the probe, and then she didn't give me any pictures, and she said my doctor would call me. After I was done, I was like, well, can I get a picture printed off of my baby? And she's like, oh, like, this computer printer's broken here, which obviously wasn't true. So I can't do them, but you can ask at the front desk if they can give you one. And I was like, okay. So she came to the front desk and asked, and they said that it wouldn't work, whatever. So I left, I went home, I cried a lot out of fear of what they were gonna tell me. And then a couple hours later, my midwives called me and had to tell me the news that, unfortunately, I don't know how I thought that I wasn't gonna cry, but anyways, unfortunately there was no fetal heart rate, and because they did the ultrasound and they did the probe, they're like certain. They told me that baby had passed around April 7th, and I think that was only like about 7 weeks old, around there. I think like 7 and maybe 8. So I got that news on the phone, and then I had to go and tell Brandon the news, which obviously he could tell from how I was. He was obviously trying to keep me positive and help me through that, but it was clear that I feel like I already knew that that was what the answer was going to be. I was told that I needed an RH shot because I had that with my first. I needed to have that again with my second. I don't know. I was just like, that's what I was told to go do, and I didn't want it to cause anything with me. I went to the ER. I couldn't get an appointment for the shot. My doctor couldn't do it, and the midwives couldn't get me an appointment. So I literally had to go wait in emergency for the entire day, sobbing. I told my family before that I had my scan and I was nervous. So then after the scan, I had texted them and I told them I didn't get any pictures. Like, something's not right. And then obviously the girl was doing her job, and like, there was nothing that she could have done. Like, she can't give me a picture or anything like that. I understand. It was just really hard. Never getting to see the baby was really difficult. And that was probably one of the hardest things for me. I told them, they tried to like, you know, make light of the situation and reassure me, but I'm sure they were all nervous and kind of expecting the news that I got. So then I had to tell them. And then, so Mia was with Brandon's family for the day because we had our scan. So I didn't see her all day. And really all I wanted was just like a hug from her. But I sat in the ER waiting for hours. I think I waited probably like 5 or 6 hours. And then once I got in, I had to wait longer. And then finally when I went in, I got the shot at some point. And then they told me my options. I either could take a pill or get a D&C, which are both technically like abortion medicine, but they had to do another scan to confirm before they gave me any of those options because they didn't have the results yet. I had to have another ultrasound, which I'm pretty sure was just on my belly. I can't remember if it was the probe or not. I don't think so. I just remember lying there staring up at like the ceiling lights, and like this, it was just so silent. And I was like, please be a heartbeat, please be a heartbeat. Like, maybe the girl did something wrong last time, like just hoping that it wasn't what they said it was. And then obviously no heartbeat. At that point I was like, it was late, I wasn't crying anymore. Mia had already gone to bed. I knew I wasn't gonna see her for the day. Talked to a gynecologist. I told her I didn't necessarily want either option at that time because like I had just found out, and I found out early at the ultrasound, my body didn't do what it needed to do. And I did have a natural birth with my daughter, and I just felt like if I didn't need to intervene, I didn't want to. I personally felt like I couldn't just let it go that quickly and just like take the pill or book the appointment. So I wanted my body to do what it does naturally. So I went home after getting my shot, and that was just to help like the blood types or whatever. I waited, I think probably like a couple weeks. Nothing happened. I literally slept with diapers on. I was wearing like giant pads. I had a towel down on my bed because I was so scared that I was gonna wake up with cramps and like blood everywhere. And like, I didn't know what could happen. They said like, sometimes people have excessive bleeding and you need to watch for that. And I was just so scared of like that whole process. And I feel like maybe me being so scared was why my body wasn't able to do what it needed to do. So I then had a follow-up appointment with my gynecologist, and the same one that I saw at the hospital. And again, you know, she was like very nice. She asked me what I wanted to do and then offered me the pill and then the D&C again. So I had a trip coming up in like the following week. So I really didn't have much time to do the pill. If the pill didn't work, I would have had to have a D&C, and then like the timing wouldn't have worked out. So I went on like a Monday, for example, and the next day they had a clinic doing D&Cs. So she called and she got me in. I went home. I was really obviously nervous, but I was at the point where I needed something to be done because I was nervous about my own health. I was going away and I didn't want it to happen while I was away. For some reason, if I had like excessive bleeding or anything like that. And then also for my mental health, I just felt disgusting. Like I felt so gross that it really like was getting into my head. And although I didn't want to make the choice to like evict the child out of my body, at that point I felt like there wasn't an option anymore. I needed to do this. So mentally I needed to do that for my own mental health. So we booked the appointment. I went in. Obviously I was really nervous. Brandon drove me. He brought me in, and then I had to go in by myself. I was just laying on a bed waiting for my appointment to be brought in. So I just had to lay there waiting, and then they wheeled me to the room. They gave me some medicine for the pain, but they didn't really give me all that much, which I was fine with. But again, there I was laying there staring up at the light. It's all kind of like, I can picture so much of it, but it's also like such a blur. Pretty much they did the D&C, which is like a vacuum, literally sucking all of the stuff from inside out. And then afterwards you still have bleeding. So I had bleeding afterwards. I couldn't like swim for 6 weeks. I couldn't use a tampon. I couldn't have sex. I couldn't do a lot of things, which again, like I didn't really care about those things anyways. Just like things for you to note if for some reason you have to have that done. And even like the thought of being sexual whatsoever just like made me feel so much guilt and like PTSD from when we first bled was because of sexual intercourse. And the nurses reassured me that that wasn't the cause, that probably the pregnancy wasn't going to be viable from the beginning. Sometimes this just happens and things don't form correctly, or you know, like it just, unfortunately, that's just how it is. And my gynecologist, the night that I went to the ER, she confirmed that as well. Like there was nothing that we had done that caused this, but yeah, they just said pretty much that there's nothing in my body or like nothing that they can see that was causing the miscarriage to happen. So for future pregnancies, you know, like all should be good. Timing wasn't right, things didn't work out. And I fully understand that, I get that. I'm not like angry. I still obviously am really sad about it, clearly. I am able to like speak openly about it to my friends or whoever. Obviously it's like a tough topic, but I think it's a topic that needs to be spoken about because I didn't know what to expect going into it. I didn't know what a D&C was. I didn't know that that was even like an option, that my body wouldn't just happen naturally. So obviously for some people, they don't know they're miscarrying, and then it just happens in the night, and that's how I felt like, that's just like what I knew a miscarriage to be. Yeah, I didn't know many people who had to go for a D&C, or I'm sure I do know people who have had miscarriages and had to go through the same thing, but I didn't know anyone openly who spoke about it. I did see a few content creators who had talked about their experience and their miscarriage. That gave me some insight, but still it wasn't the same story as mine, which I'm sure everyone's story is different, but I did want to educate on having to have a D&C and what the process was like. So now to have a viable pregnancy again. So I got two different answers. The first one was that I have to wait 3 months for three period cycles to be regular. And then the other one was that I needed just to have a regular period cycle, and then you should take 3 months of prenatals. So pretty much 3 months is the number. But I just feel like honestly, my body, maybe it just wasn't ready to be pregnant again. I had stopped breastfeeding when Mia was one. My body was just getting back to, you know, doing its thing, being my body again. My hormones for sure were not regulated correctly. So I do feel like, you know, looking back, I'm like, I understand why things didn't work out how I wanted them to. You know, I'm gonna try to take better care of my body now so that in the future, when I do try again to get pregnant, that it will hopefully stick. Like they said, there's nothing really that I could have done to control it, but I think there are things that I can do to help, hopefully make it a better environment for the baby for next time. I still obviously would love to have a baby. I see babies now and I feel more than ever like I have like baby fever, or like a desire to just like have that newborn snuggle, which obviously I think is just, I'm picturing what it would have been like to have my baby. What really makes me upset is seeing other people who have children my daughter's age that I've been friends with online and such, and I want to be so happy for them because they're having their second, and seeing so many people announcing their second pregnancies, and I am so happy for them and I think it's so amazing and such a blessing, but it still hurts me to see or to know that like that would have been me. I would have been announcing a pregnancy or just being so excited to welcome another baby into the world. But you know, Brandon and I have obviously worked through it, and we just feel like, you know, timing wasn't right, and looking back, like we get it, but it still doesn't make it hurt any less. Obviously we understand, we appreciate Mia even more than we did before. I feel like she's just like such a little ray of sunshine, and everything she does we're just like obsessed with, so we're just like taking that in and soaking her up as much as possible as a family of three right now. One day, hopefully, we will be a family of four or more. But right now, this is like where our paths are, and we're just lucky to have Mia, because I know some people have to go through this and they don't have any children. So I am very grateful that we have her. And she just loves babies so much, and like I just love that she's so loving, and she has all these babies that she plays with, like her dolls, and she just loves them so much. And I know one day we'll be able to give her a sibling and she'll be the best big sissy ever, but right now just wasn't the time. Although I really want a baby, I am really scared, and that's something that I don't think I'll really get past even during my next pregnancy. I'm gonna be very cautious. I'm going to pretty much do nothing like I did my first pregnancy, because with my first pregnancy I was so scared because it was my first pregnancy. I didn't know how my body was going to react to pregnancy. I didn't know if I was able to hold a pregnancy. With my second, I thought, I've done this before, you know, like this is gonna be great, I'm so excited, I'm gonna work out, I'm gonna be able to like be more physical and do things. So I didn't slow down as much as I did with the first, and again, like they said, there was nothing that we did that caused this. The second, I know I'm just literally gonna sit on the couch and do nothing. Like I want to be as careful as possible. But yeah, so I'm just waiting my three cycles out. I will start taking prenatals, all that, but we don't really have a plan to conceive anytime soon. We're just taking it as it is right now and still processing. I think that during my next pregnancy, I'm gonna be really nervous to have that ultrasound, any ultrasound really. You know, I am hopeful, I am grateful. My body still really doesn't feel like my body. I feel soft and bloated, and I just like I don't like to get dressed. I don't like to get ready. I feel really, really emotional, clearly, about this topic, but just in general, about literally anything. Like, I cry probably every day still, and it's not necessarily about this topic. I feel like I have postpartum mental fog. My brain just isn't there. Like, I'm not in it right now, and I'm just trying to make it through. Obviously, if you are a subscriber of mine or you follow my content, I have for sure been lacking in that department. I just can't really wrap my head around much right now, other than just like being in the moment and playing with Mia and just loving her as much as I can. I'm having a hard time with my body. I'm having a hard time with my emotions. I am going to try to get my hormones in balance and do things that make me happy and just like take a step back a little bit, reassess, reevaluate. But yeah, I think I'm on the way to being in a better mindset and to feeling better in general. I know everything, it happens how it's supposed to, but that is our story. Sorry for the tears. I hope this maybe helped you a little bit to get more insight into what the process is like. Hopefully you never need to know what the process is like, but I know out of curiosity, I've watched some videos like this before, and it definitely helped me when I was going through it, just to know that there are so many women who go through this, and it is crazy to think that the number is so high on miscarriage rates that you don't really like hear people talk about it as often as it happens. And I never want to be like, boo-hoo, poor me, but I do feel like this is something important in my life that has happened, and I feel like I am obligated to share to hopefully help other women in the future to understand what it's like to go through this. But that is my story on our miscarriage and the process surrounding it, how I'm doing, and yeah, the aftermath of it, I guess. But yeah, that is everything for this video. Something else I want to say before signing off is to remember that your spouse is also going through this, and to offer them support and give them what they need. They might not be going through exactly what you're going through, but they are also dealing with the loss of their child or what they had hoped their future would look like with their child. So just be kind to them as well and know that everyone deals with things differently. But I hope this video give you some education and insight into what's been going on. If you follow me, like I said, I just wanted to kind of give some insight into where I've been because I share my life online. So that is why I've been struggling a little bit mentally, emotionally, work-wise, trying to keep up. But that's everything. So I hope you guys have an amazing day, week, month, or year. I love you, and remember to always be nice to people.